But my God says to the prodigal, my beloved one, you're welcome home. Oh, your mercy triumphs over judgment.
Is born.
No less God within the shadows, no less.
Greetings to everyone watching this Easter Sunday worship service from home as we celebrate the truly good news. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Trusting that Christ is present in all times and in all places, we will celebrate virtual communion later in the service. All are welcome to participate. If you'd like to do so, I invite you at this time to gather some form of bread and some form of wine or grape juice, and I will offer further instructions later in the service. If you'd like to follow along with the words of our congregational songs and prayers, bulletins are available on our website, stjohnslutheran.church. And now I invite you to worship the God who is with us and for us forever.
Grave he lay, Jesus. Jesus, my Savior. He tore the bars away, Jesus, my Lord. Up from the grave he arose, with mighty triumph for his foes.
He
rose up, picked from the dark domain, and he lives forever with the saints to reign.
We join together in giving thanks for our baptism. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Refreshed by the resurrection life we share in Christ, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We thank you, risen Christ, that your Spirit comes to us in the grace-filled waters of rebirth, like rains to our thirsting earth, like streams that revive our souls, like cups of cool water shared with strangers. Breathe your peace on your church when we hide in fear. Clothe us with your mercy and forgiveness. Send us companions on our journey as we share your life. Make us one, risen Christ. Cleanse our hearts. Shower us with life. To you be given all praise with the Holy Spirit in the glory of God, now and forever. Amen.
Now the darkness fades into new beginnings as we lift our eyes to a hope beyond. Our creation waits with an expectation to declare the reign of the Lord our God. We will not be moved when the earth gives way.
Yeah.
We join together in our prayer of the day. God of mercy, we no longer look for Jesus among the dead, for he is alive and has become the Lord of life. Increase in our minds and hearts the risen life we share with Christ, and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 25. More than 700 years before Christ, the prophet Isaiah proclaims the good news of God's salvation and calls all people to rejoice. God will make a rich feast for all people. God will wipe the tears from their eyes. And most importantly, God will destroy death itself. The reading. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wines strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears of all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, "Lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." the end of the reading.
Our second reading is found in Acts chapter 10, verses 34 through 43. Peter crosses the immense religious and social boundary that separates Jews from Gentiles in order to proclaim the good news of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, so that God's forgiveness in Jesus' name would reach out to all people. The reading. Peter began to speak to the people. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as a judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name.
Forever he is lifted.
Thank you, Diane and Megan. Our gospel reading for today is from the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter, beginning with the first verse. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. Here ends the reading. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I've shared in previous sermons that one day, while I was at Fuller Seminary in Pasadena, I was browsing through Roman's bookstore when the cover of a greeting card caught my eye. It read, "Everything will be okay in the end. If it's not okay, it's not the end." I bought that card and I stuck it on my front door, because I believe it expresses a profound spiritual truth. The gospel truth we celebrate this Easter and that feels especially relevant in these days. The truth we know in Jesus Christ, our risen Savior and Lord. Everything will be okay in the end. If it's not okay, it's not the end. This is the reality experienced by the disciples as they accompanied Jesus during his 3 years of public ministry. Disciples like Peter. Disciples like Mary Magdalene. The disciples were with Jesus as he demonstrated God's powerful, healing, life-giving love, turning water to wine at a wedding in Cana, feeding thousands on a hillside with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, restoring life to his beloved friend Lazarus. They were with Jesus as he declared, "I am the light of the world," revealing who God is and who we are as God's beloved children. As he declared, "I am the way and the truth and the life," revealing in his words and actions what is real and authentic and good. As he declared, "I am the good shepherd who lays down his life for the sheep, and the sheep hear my voice and follow me." They were with Jesus as he taught them about life and showed them how to live and gave them a new commandment: love one another as I have loved you. And they came to believe that Jesus Christ is fully human and fully divine, the God of all creation in the flesh, the God who created the heavens and the earth and rested on the 7th day, who placed the first man and first woman in a garden, who gives us life, the God who made everything very good in the beginning and will make everything very good in the end. Everything will be okay in the end, even when it's not okay. Imagine you are Peter on that Thursday night in the Garden of Gethsemane, watching as his friend and mentor, the one he believed would save him and his people from oppression, the one he called Lord, was betrayed and arrested and taken away by soldiers in the middle of the night. And then following behind at a distance and denying that he even knew Jesus 3 times, turning his back on Jesus and leaving in bitter tears. What did Peter feel when he heard Jesus was dead? Imagine you are Mary Magdalene on that Friday at the crucifixion, watching as the one to whom she devoted her life, the one who had set her free, the most loving, courageous, wisest person she knew, was brought before an angry mob who called for his death. She saw him beaten and bloodied and mocked. She saw him nailed to a cross. She saw him die. And she saw where his body was laid in haste and without ceremony, not even properly prepared for burial, because the Sabbath was coming when no work could be done. And then the day after the Sabbath, early on the first day of the week, early on that Sunday morning, as soon as she could while it was still dark, Mary went to the tomb to properly prepare his body and mourn his loss. And when she goes there, she finds the tomb empty. The stone is rolled away. Someone, either those who had killed him or grave robbers or the gardener or someone else, had taken the body, and she didn't know where, and she couldn't even mourn properly. And so she runs to get help, runs to those closest to Jesus, Peter and the beloved disciple, and they all run back to the tomb, and they see the grave clothes of Jesus lying there in the empty tomb. Clothes that were neatly folded and placed. indicating that this was not a grave robbery, not a hasty act, but the calm and confident work of someone leaving grave clothes behind. Peter doesn't yet understand this. The beloved disciple believes, but he also does not fully yet understand. And so they leave. And Mary is left standing there, outside the tomb. Not even the appearance of two angels takes away her tears. She doesn't understand. Her heart is broken. She feels alone, weeping in the dark. Everything was not okay. But it was not the end. Imagine you are Mary Magdalene seeing Jesus alive. Though at first, she doesn't recognize him. Perhaps because of her tears, perhaps because of her grief, perhaps because she is so focused on Jesus missing from the tomb that she doesn't see Jesus standing right there beside her. At first, she supposes that he is the gardener, someone who tends to creation, who helps things grow, who fosters life. Here they are, a man and a woman in a garden, on the first day, also the eighth day of the week, a day of new creation, new life, new possibilities. At first, Mary doesn't realize that the very one asking her, "Whom are you seeking?" is the one she seeks. Doesn't realize that the question, "Why are you weeping?" is rhetorical because there is no longer reason to weep. Doesn't realize that the one she wants to take with her is already there. And then he says her name, Mary. And everything changes. She recognizes the voice of her good shepherd. He knows her and she knows him, her teacher. The one to whom she had devoted her life, the one who set her free, the most loving, courageous, wisest person she knows is alive, is standing there right beside her, is calling her name. Imagine her joy. She embraces Jesus and wants to hold him tight. But she can't keep Jesus all to herself. She needs to share him. And so Jesus commissions her to go and tell her fellow disciples the truly good news that he is risen indeed. He is alive. He is ascending to God the Father. This is perhaps my favorite moment in all of Scripture. And I chose this as the gospel reading for my ordination as a minister of word and sacrament. And in the sermon he preached at my ordination, Bishop Murray Fink said that this was, in a way, Mary's ordination, to preach the gospel. And she does. She goes and tells her fellow disciples, "I have seen the Lord." She shares her experience of Jesus. She is the very first to proclaim the resurrection, the first to speak the good news, the apostle to the apostles. Imagine you are Peter hearing this news, and then later that night, being in a room behind locked doors when Jesus suddenly appears and says, "Peace be with you," to the disciples who had deserted him. And then breathes into them the Holy Spirit and sends them out as the Father sent him, in peace, in love, in life. What did Peter feel when he saw Jesus alive? And then, after spending 40 more days with his disciples, as he told Mary he would, Jesus ascended into heaven. He returned to God the Father to prepare a place for us. And one day, he will come again and make all things new. In his life, in his death, in his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ joined with us so that we might join with him, suffered alongside us so that we know we never suffer alone in this broken world, took our sin and death as his own and ultimately freed us from them, gives us his eternal and abundant life, life now and forever, life that does not end. And while our experience of Jesus is different than Peter and Mary Magdalene and those first disciples on that first Easter morn, Christ is present with us here and now in the Holy Spirit who fills and sustains and guides us, in his words through which he continues to teach us, in his example, through which he continues to inspire us, in the bread and wine of communion that are his body and blood given for us, in this beloved community of faith, in each one of us, Jesus calls us by name, commissions us to go and tell the good news, sends us out in peace, in love, in life. And so I invite you into an ever fuller and deeper relationship with Jesus Christ through prayer, through studying his words and actions in Scripture, through staying connected with this community of faith, through reaching out to loved ones and supporting each other in faith, in hope, in love. I invite you to trust. Everything will be okay in the end, even when it's not okay. Even as we are slowly emerging from a global pandemic and all the losses that we are still grieving, even as we experience the pain and sorrow as we live in this fallen, sinful, broken world, even when we don't understand and our heart is broken and we feel alone, weeping in the dark, we are not alone. Christ is right there with us, even when we don't see him through our tears. Christ is there, standing beside us, caring for us, calling us by name. And so I invite you, in those moments of pain and sorrow and anxiety, to take a deep breath. Feel God's arms of love wrapped around you. Reach out to family and friends. Find support. Remember, if it's not okay, it's not the end. In a reflection he wrote about his wife, Catherine, as she was nearing the end of her time on earth, E.B. White, who wrote Charlotte's Web and Stuart Little, among many others, wrote about her gardening and her faith. Armed with a diagram and a clipboard, Catherine would get into a shabby old Brooks raincoat, much too long for her, put on a little round wool hat, pull on a pair of overshoes, and proceed to the director's chair, a folding canvas thing, that had been placed for her at the edge of the plot. There she would sit, hour after hour, in the wind and the weather, while Henry Ellen produced dozens of brown paper packages of new bulbs and a basketful of old ones, ready for the intricate internment. As the years went by and age overtook her, there was something comical yet touching in her bedraggled appearance on this awesome occasion. The small, hunched-over figure, her studied absorption in the implausible notion that there would be yet another spring. Oblivious to the ending of her own days, which she knew perfectly well were near at hand, sitting here with her detailed chart under those dark skies in the dying October, calmly plotting the resurrection. Christ arose, and so will we. Christ lives, and so do we. In him, we have life now, and we have life forever. In him, everything will be okay in the end. Amen.
Jesus Christ lay, death in his grave.
down in grief, but oh, cold in keys to hell on that day.
We join together in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Alive in the risen Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit, we bring our prayers before God, who promises to hear us and answer in steadfast love. Life-giving God, praise to you for your power revealed in the resurrection. Fill your church with the power of your love that is stronger than death. Send us to tell the good news of salvation in your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for your gift of life in the resurrection. Fill all of creation with your grace. Bring it to blossom and flourish. Use it to remind us of your goodness. Cultivate our care for all you have made. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for the peace made possible in the resurrection. Fill the nations with your harmony. Draw people together to work for the common good. Renew new possibilities and inspire new beginnings. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for the joy of the resurrection. Fill us with joy as your beloved community. Multiply that joy so that we share it with others wherever we go. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for the hope of the resurrection. Fill all in need with hope, those who are anxious or afraid, those who are sick or suffering, those who are lonely or grieving. Assure them of your presence and your promises. Especially today, we pray for those whom we name silently in our hearts or aloud. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Praise to you for your faithfulness revealed in the resurrection. Fill us with trust that we join with all who have gone before us in proclaiming your mercy endures forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty and loving God, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in the work of your Holy Spirit to bring all things into the risen life of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. As we continue to provide for the spiritual and physical needs of our community, we continue to be deeply grateful for your financial support. There are a couple ways you can give. You can give online on our website, stjohnslutheran.church, clicking on the Give button in the top right corner. You can also mail a check to us here at St. John's. Our mailing address and other information is available on our website. Please give as you feel called and able to do so. And please know that any amount you give is deeply appreciated.
When he rolls up his sleeves, he ain't just putting on the Ritz. There's thunder in his footsteps and lightning in his fists.
Our God is an awesome God.
And the Lord wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very close, and so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God.
Our God is an awesome God. He raised from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He raised from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God.
Now when the sky was starless in the void of the night, spoke into the darkness and created the light.
Our God is an awesome God.
In judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom, and mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. I hope that we have not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God.
Our God.
At this time of virtual communion, I invite you to gather the bread and the wine or grape juice. I will offer the words of institution, and then we will sing the Lord's Prayer together. And then at that time, I will invite you to take and eat and take and drink. And I'll pause to allow all members of the household time to partake of the elements. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who, on the cross, opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me. And together we sing the prayer that our Lord and Savior taught us to pray.
Our Father.
Now I invite you to take and eat the body of Christ given for you. I invite you to take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us all of our days. Amen. Let us pray. Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us and send us as rejoicing witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Just a few announcements as we bring this Easter worship service to a close. We do, of course, continue to live stream our worship services Sunday mornings at 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. available on our website, our YouTube channel, and our Facebook page. We are also meeting for in-person worship at this time with worship services at 8, 9:30, and 11 a.m. If you would like to join us for those in-person worship services, please visit our website, stjohnslutheran.church, for more information. Also, the information on all of our worship and ministry opportunities, in addition to being available on our website, is available in the email blast that I've been sending out regularly with words of information and encouragement. If you're not on that email distribution list but would like to be, and or if you are in need of prayer or pastoral care, and or if you have questions about St. John's, please do send me an email. My email is pastor@stjohnslutheran.church. And now, receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Oh.
Go in peace. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.